Good morning, Heath Church. Wow. There is a lot of folks here today. What a blessing on this Resurrection Sunday. Thank you for coming to Heath Church today to worship with us. I know you have many choices out there, but we're so happy that you came to worship with us today on this Lord's Day. If you're a visiting friend or a family member come in with someone that already comes here, we have a connections card. And in the back of your bulletin, you can fill out that information in there. And there's also a prayer request list on the back if you'd like. Fill that out, and on your way out after the service today, there's a little black box in the foyer, and you can just drop it in there. We'd just like to say thank you for visiting with us today. And if you're looking for a church, we'd love to have you. So just fill that out and drop her in the box, and I can be in touch later with you. But thank you so much for coming. And I can't forget all of you faithful attendees. Thank you so much for continuing to worship here at Heath with us. Today we've got just a couple quick announcements. We have a lot going on today. I'm excited about it. But our brand new pictorial directory, that is coming up this Friday, Saturday, or I'm sorry, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday for the photo session. So if you have not done so, we need everybody's participation. And if you can get on that QR code in the bulletin or see me after, and I can get you a sheet with the website. I need you to sign up because it's this coming Thursday. We still have several dates available, or several times on those dates available. So just see me after and we will get you put into that directory and the photo sessions. But we do need everybody's participation if we can. And also for you that don't know, the visiting family members and friends, we have the staff nursery is open today. If you need to take your children over to the nursery, it's in the next building over, the Family Life Center, the large building to the right here. And you can come in the front door. It'll be immediately on your right. Or you can get one of our ushers to guide you over there. So don't be shy and ask them to show you the way. And check your bulletins for upcoming events. And there's also a prayer concern list in the center of that bulletin. So we look forward to you having that with you during the week. And you can not only have your prayer request, but you can look at the groups and events that are coming up. Something like the Brunch Buds on Tuesday mornings. We'd love for you to join in there. So if you're able, please stand. And we're going to praise with the praise team in worship song.
Thank you, Pastor Murr. I certainly concur with Pastor Murr. It is a joy to be here to welcome you all for Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Amen. We come here to church today for the highlight of the year. If you're a believer here today, Easter is our highlight. It should be our biggest holiday of the year if you are a believer here today. I think you know the response, so let's kick it off this morning. He is risen. One more time. He is risen. Amen. Let's worship in song as we celebrate our risen Savior because he lives. We welcome you to church and we welcome you to worship. Thank you.
this morning. We have a reason to be very grateful and to celebrate this morning. We serve a risen Savior.
Was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me. Thank you.
Amen. We serve a risen Savior. He came, He died. His blood was shed on the cross for our sins, for yours and for mine. He would have done it if it was just one of us. He died on that cross, but then 3 days later, He rose again. And He now lives at the right hand of our Father. And we are now called His sons and His daughters because of the blood of Jesus Christ shed on that cross. Praise His name this morning. He is worthy. He is worthy. Lift Him above all else. We give Him praise and glory and thanksgiving this morning. I want to sing that song all over again, the whole thing, because I just can't pick any words to leave out this morning. We were a wretch. We were. That's in the past tense. If we accept His forgiveness and His grace this morning. I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. That breach was far too wide. But from the far side of that chasm, You held me in Your sight. So You made a way for me across that great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. There at the cross, You paid a debt that I owed. You broke my chains, freed my soul, and for the first time, I had hope. Thank You, Jesus, for that blood applied. Thank You, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank You, Jesus, You have saved my life. You brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Let's sing those words together.
Was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. But from the far side, and there at the cross.
mighty Father, this morning, we lift your name above all else. We magnify you. We thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for your praise and worship. You may be seated. If our ushers will come forward and receive our giving through our tithes and offerings.
From heaven, the stone was rolled away. And as dead men, the guards, they all stood there in fright as the power of love displayed its might. And suddenly a melody filled the air, riding. It was everywhere. The world.
And I say, praise the Lord. How about you? Thank the Lord we serve a risen Savior this Sunday morning. He's alive and He's alive forevermore. Thank you, Junior Choir, for that wonderful presentation. Thank you for your good singing a little earlier in the service. So good to be in God's house this Easter Sunday morning. Resurrection Lord's Day, the very high day in the Christian calendar. What a joy to praise and worship and serve Him. And we welcome each and every one of you who is here. God bless you for your presence in the house of the Lord this morning. We're so grateful to have you with us worshiping. As a couple of the pastors have already mentioned, if you're visiting with us today, we welcome you back. If you don't have a home church, others of you who've come from a distance and here just this weekend, we're so glad you're here. All the home folks, welcome. We're here to worship the Lord. We're not here to put on a performance, not here for a big production. We're here to worship the Lord. And we're praising God for the privilege we have of doing just that. Am I getting a little bit of a ring, or is that my imagination? Just a little bit of ring there. Thank you, Tim. The joys we have of rejoicing in God's presence and serving a risen Savior today. Praise the Lord. We want to go to God in prayer this morning. As we're praying, there are so many things for which to praise the Lord. Don't forget to thank Him. Most importantly, that we serve a Savior who's alive and alive forevermore. There are also requests and burdens and needs. Let us remember today, keep remembering the family of Leon McCroskey. And by the way, it is so good, April, to see you back at Heath. Did you mind standing? I want to thank you this morning. Come on, you can do it. You can do it. Amen. Oh, God bless you. God bless you. This precious lady has stood by her husband so faithfully, almost eight months in the hospital. A week ago today, we celebrated Leon's life as he went on to heaven. But we're praising God for the wonderful, wonderful assurance of comfort. And April, we are praying for you, dear. We love you so much. Pray also for the family of Adam Studebaker. Our dear Adam passed away suddenly and unexpectedly just this past Friday. So pray earnestly for Sandra and all of this family grieving. It's difficult anytime. It just seems especially difficult here on Resurrection Weekend. Let's remember the family of Adam Studebaker. Pray for God's touch, God's blessing to them. So many others, ill, recovering, etc., etc. So many needs. Our youth pastor, Pastor Eric, comes to lead us in our prayer time. Let's all pray. Get a hold of God this morning and believe Him.
Let's pray. God, my Father, God, I thank You for this day that we have, this day, Resurrection Sunday, that God, we get to come to Your house today, that we get to worship You this morning, that God, we get to worship the fact that the tomb is empty. That God, the stone is rolled away and Your Son is alive and with You now. Because God, without a risen Savior, there is no point for church. There's no point for Christianity without the resurrection of Your Son. But God, You loved us enough that You sent Your Son Jesus to die on a cross for our sins. God, words cannot describe how thankful I am that Your love and Your grace and Your mercy was manifested to me and to each and every one of us freely, that God, we could spend an eternity with You in heaven. God, now my heart weeps for the recent loss of several of our church members. God, I remember Brother Leon, and I just pray for Miss April, God, and I just pray that You would comfort that family, God, that You would just bless them, that God, You would comfort them, that God, You would just manifest Yourself in a way that only You can. God, my heart is heavy for the Studebaker family and those that are close to Adam. God, as myself, as I've been over there many times. God, I just pray for that family, that God, You would comfort them, that God, You would bless them, that God, though we weep, our hearts are heavy, God, we remember that the tomb is empty, and that we serve a resurrected Savior. We serve a God of love, and we serve a God of grace, and we serve a God of mercy, and we serve a God who cares about our needs. That God, one of your names is El Roy. That God, you are a God who is seeing us. Like you saw Hagar and Ishmael in the wilderness, God, you encouraged them, and God, you manifested yourself to them. God, I pray now that those that are going through a loss right now, that they would remember the name El Roy, that God, you see them. God, you see us on mountaintops. You see us in the valleys. God, I just pray that we would remember who you are in your name. God, I pray for those that are sick, those are hurting, those are in the hospital. I remember Ricky Harrison and many others that are in the hospital now that couldn't be here this morning. God, I pray for our shut-ins. I pray for those who just couldn't make it this morning. God, I just pray for them that you would ease any discomfort that they're in. God, that you would just reveal yourself in a mighty way. And God, I just pray as we continue to worship you this morning that our hearts would dwell with you this morning, that God, we would draw close to the foot of the cross, and that we would not just treat this as any other resurrection Sunday. We would not treat this like any other Easter. That God, we would remember that the tomb is empty, the stone is rolled away, and that we can have eternal life through the blood of your Son, God. And I pray all of these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen. God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor, for that prayer. We praise the Lord this morning that he hears and he answers prayer. Can I get an amen on that today? Amen. I'd like to tell you a real quick story, if that's all right. Do you like good stories? I'll try to keep it short. A lot going on this morning, but let me tell you a quick story. I happen to love bluegrass music. Yeah, I see about two or three of you at least out there. I know several of you do. I've loved it for years and years. I'll usually hear 5 to 7 professional bluegrass groups perform in person through a year's time. I just love to go hear them, love the music, love the singing, love the instrumentation. Well, a few weeks ago, our brother Ron Scruggs down here called me and he said, "Hey, Dan," said, "I've got an old friend from years ago back in Kansas and knew him well back then, haven't seen him for years." He said he is playing and singing in a professional bluegrass group. He said, "They're going to be in a concert down here in Charlotte. Would you like to go?" I said, "Who is it?" He said, "It's the Special Consensus." I said, "Well, of course I want to go. They're one of the top groups in bluegrass." And so we went to the concert. It was wonderful. And afterward, of course, Ron was hooking up with his old friend from years back. And I got to meet this new friend of mine, a man by the name of Greg Blake. And he's the lead singer and acoustic guitar player for the great group Special Consensus. And as we chatted after the concert, we found out that Greg and his new bride, and welcome, Joy Sue, we're so glad to have you this morning, said he and his new bride had just moved to North Carolina. They'd just become Tar Heels. We thought that was cool. "Well, where'd you move in North Carolina?" He said, "Well, it's a little town called Lexington." Amen. Amen. Oh, Ron and I about lost our dentures. We said, "Lexington?" I said, "I know you've just moved here. Have you found a home church yet?" He said, "Well, we just moved." And of course, he's on the road most weeks. And he said, "But my wife and I have been talking. We need to find a church to visit. I'm off from traveling on Easter Sunday." Said, "We need to find a church for Easter." I said, "I can help you with that." So we had a good chat and ended up where we're so honored this morning. First time here at Heath Church. To have this wonderful man of God, he's been a pastor for many years and now for several years traveling in bluegrass music, not only with Special Consensus, but has his own group, Hometown. And we are just honored. Before you officially welcome him, I want you to know that you are welcoming, are you listening? Yes. You're welcoming the 2023 International Bluegrass Music Association Male Vocalist of the Year. Come on, Brother Greg. Greg Blake.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate that so much. I'm just happy to be here with my wife and worshiping with you. Yes. I've already felt like we've met God this morning. So let's just continue to worship him today. I believe it was the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah that says, you know, his mercies are renewed every morning. And I'm appreciative of that. I'm not necessarily a morning person. I'm a musician, so I'm not a morning person. But But I'm thankful for the prospect that God says that every day is brand new in Jesus Christ. And especially today as we celebrate and worship and honor the fact that he was victorious over death, hell, and the grave. And that gives us hope. And I sure like the prospects of hope. Hope you enjoy this song this morning. They all walked away with nothing to say. They had just lost their dearest friend. All that he'd said, now he was dead. So this was the way it should end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they seemed. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, hammer, the nails, how could a night be so long? Then came the morning, night turned into day, the stone was rolled away, hope rose with the dawn.
Thank you so much, Brother Greg. Can I tell you what a privilege and joy it is to have you with us today? Thank you for that powerful and wonderful song. I'm glad the morning came, aren't you? We don't have to live in darkness. Friend, if your life is surrounded with darkness this morning, the morning is dawned and light is here. What a beautiful reminder of that in that wonderful song. And by the way, Heath Church, Greg and Joy Sue Blake are welcome back here any Sunday. They're free and able to come. Amen? Amen? Amen. Thank you again for that wonderful song. Would you turn in your Bibles this morning to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28. The gospel according to Matthew chapter 28. I'm reading just a part of verse 1 this morning. I've told you, the congregation of Heath Church, this every Easter morning for the last 40 years. I've told you there's just something about getting up early on Easter morning, seeing the sun begin to rise, hearing the birds begin to sing, and thinking of the fact that we serve a risen Savior. I love Resurrection Sunday. Praise the Lord. Matthew 21, beginning to read with verse 1 and reading only a part of verse 1 today. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the tomb. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn on the first day of the week. I'm using as a text just 12 words found in the heart of this verse that I've just read. I just quoted them a moment ago. As it began to dawn toward the first day of the week. Father in heaven, I ask for your Holy Spirit's help this morning as we look to your word. Nothing any more important on Easter Sunday than your divinely inspired and written word. Speak to us this morning, I pray. Guide us in these next few moments and deal with our hearts through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You should have a little study sheet in your bulletin this morning if you'd like to fill in a couple blanks and take down a note or two and sort of keep track of where we are, where we've been, where we're going. I welcome you to do that. Hopefully the Holy Spirit will speak to you about something that you'd like to jot down that's not already in the prepared note sheet. But the title of the message I feel on my heart for this morning is simply, Then Came the Morning. I've told you the story of meeting Brother Greg a few weeks ago when I asked him after that concert when he said, well, I think we'd love to be there on Sunday morning at Heath Church. And I said, well, why don't you sing? And he so kindly consented, and we appreciated that beautiful song. But because we're having several special songs this morning, I said, Greg, if you know what you're going to sing, I'd like to know the title so we won't walk on each other with resurrection songs and duplicate. He said, Dan, I'd like to sing Then Came the Morning. And I want to tell you, ever since the moment he told me that, that phrase has been on my mind these past few weeks. I've never preached a sermon with that title. I've never even preached a sermon from this brief text. But I've been thinking about it, rejoicing in the Lord now for several weeks on that glorious, glorious truth. Then came the morning. As a small boy, I had a morbid fear of the dark. It was real. It was horrible. Again, the word morbid describes it well. I was scared to death as a little fella in the dark. We lived on a small farm up in northeast Ohio and had lots of chores, of course. Even us kids had lots of chores. By the way, it's a good thing to give your children chores. Amen. I had lots of them. And a couple of those chores that I had to perform day by day, or as it were, night by night, were chores that I performed in solitary, yea, in nocturnal solitary. One of those things that my parents asked me to do every evening was simply take out the garbage. Now, when I say garbage, I don't mean trash. I mean garbage. Biodegradable stuff, food scraps, that sort of thing. We put out big gardens and raised a lot of the food that we ate back in those days, and So we kept a compost pile, and my dad carefully built that and worked that as it would help the ground in the garden. And my job every evening, and when I say evening, it seemed like invariably the sun had already gone down when it was time to take out that garbage. My mother usually had a big basin filled with it, a rubber basin, and she'd say, Daniel, it's all finished, time to take it out. And I'd start the horrible, perilous journey toward the compost pile. I don't know why they didn't put it any closer to the house. I guess probably because of how it would have smelled. But it was way up past the back driveway, off across from the barn, and up in some horrible, scary, scary trees. And time and again, I would get partway on that journey, and I was reaching the point of the compost pile, and I was still about only half to two-thirds of the way there, and it was just too much. The darkness had closed in with its sinister threats. Those trees there in the dark were waving their menacing fingers at me. And more than once, I'll have to admit, more than once, about only two-thirds of the way to the compost pile, I just gave that old basin of garbage a big sling and turned and ran back to the house. I don't know why it never dawned on me. And by the way, welcome to all of you over here in the wing. I don't know why it never dawned on me that I'd be discovered the next morning. Big string of garbage and smelly scraps all over the edge of the yard. And I'm sure more than once, Daddy said, you'll pick that up, son, and you'll pick it up with your own hands, and you don't need any gloves. Pick it up. I guess he didn't want me to grow up to be a sissy, so he didn't figure the dark would hurt me. But even worse than taking out the garbage was the task of taking the empty canning jars down to the basement. As I said, we grew big gardens back in those days, raised most of what we ate, and so we did a lot of home canning. And after we'd get 6 or 8 jars emptied, my mother would say, Daniel, time to take the empties back to the basement. Now again, when I say basement, that's probably a misnomer. You're probably thinking of some nice, well-lighted, sheet-rocked-in, dry, cheery place like basements seem to be today. No, no. I don't even know that I'd call that horrible bottom pit under our old farmhouse a basement. I would probably call it an old cellar. Anybody know that term? A few of you do. Old crumbling concrete block walls and mildew and mold and damp and dingy and cobwebs. Well, to get to that cellar, I had to go down a set of rickety old steps that went off the back of the kitchen. Halfway down those steps, there was a landing. Just to the right of that landing, there was a ledge in a recessed area, probably about 3 feet, that ledge right there by the landing, and we'd store boxes and stuff there. It was the way they'd built the house, and there on the landing, that ledge was right to the right, and then you had to go on down the second half of the steps, and things were getting worse and worse always, because the light switches for those old naked light bulbs that hung down there in that awful cellar, of course, were down there in that awful cellar. So you'd have to get clear down the steps and feel around out there among the ghosts and the goblins and the monsters and the mean men and find that light switch and finally get it on and put the jars where they're supposed to be. While I was headed down, this was my most feared task. It really was. I got the jars. I headed down the first panel of those steps. However, my older brother, 6 years my senior, had positioned himself on that ledge in the pitch dark, just waiting, because he'd heard my mom say, Dan, it's about time to take the jars to the basement, and he knew I'd put it off long enough for him to get positioned, and there he was, but I had no idea he was there. Well, I got halfway down, just scared to death already. Those jars were rattling in the flat, and all of a sudden, something grabbed me. And then there was a scream. Believe me, it wasn't the last scream. It's a miracle it didn't drop and break all those jars. Horrible experience. I hated the dark. You know, darkness is actually quite a thing when you think about it. There's really no way to adequately describe or define darkness other than to say darkness. Darkness is simply the absence of light. Ever think about that? That's really the definition of darkness. And light, on the other hand, is a wonderful, wonderful thing. Ephesians 5:13 tells us simply that light is that which makes manifest. In other words, it shows us what lies before us, what lies around us, what lies behind us. Light reveals, light illuminates, where darkness is and does the exact opposite of all those good things. The crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, as I've already stated, stand as the central events in Christian theology. But I believe not only are the crucifixion and resurrection of our Lord the main events of Christian theology, but I believe also there are profound symbolisms of great spiritual significance that also surround many of these events of the crucifixion and the resurrection. For you'll remember at the crucifixion, as Jesus hung on that cross right in the middle of the day, do you remember what happened? A thick, thick darkness descended upon the land. And again, I believe that darkness was a reflection of the somber reality of humanity's sinfulness. Jesus is bearing the sins of the world, yea, bearing yours and mine. And God the Father drew the black thick curtain across that scene for about 3 hours. I believe it was a representation of the blackness and the darkness of sinful humanity. For you see, the darkness of evil at that point in the midst of the crucifixion, the black darkness of evil seemed to be winning. And yet we know that out of that darkness emerged the ultimate light. As we've been singing and rejoicing already, that ultimate light, which is the resurrection of our Lord. And that great event, that glorious resurrection, illuminated. It turned the lights on. It illuminated a dark, sin-cursed world with the divine light of eternal life. Are you with me this morning? And yet we know that out of that darkness, a darkness we don't have to remain in, out of that darkness emerged the glorious light. I want you to think with me for just a few minutes this morning. And I know we've got a lot going on today in celebrating the resurrection, and I believe that's a good thing. But I want you to think with me for a little while, first of all, about the darkness that surrounded the crucifixion of Jesus. For I believe, as I've stated already, that darkness symbolized the weight of sin and the brokenness of humanity. And as Jesus bore the sins of the world on the cross, as he was hanging there between heaven and earth for you and me, both, I should say, all three of the first gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all record the fact that a literal darkness descended upon the land. In Luke 23:44, Luke states, and I quote, "It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. because the sun's light failed." And friends, that literal darkness that descended in that fateful moment, as I've already mentioned a couple times, I believe represents to us in all of its Stygian blackness, represents to us the horrible condition of fallen, sinful humanity. Friends, we needed help. Born in sin, born into the darkness of the sinful nature and the blackness that the devil could inspire in every life and heart. Think with me for a moment about all the human experiences and conditions that so evidence the darkness of sinful humanity at and around Jesus' crucifixion. Here's what I want you to do. As I look at these different manifestations of darkness for just a couple of minutes, as we look at the various individuals that were actors and players in the drama of Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection, as we observe some of the types of darkness that surrounded their lives, I'm asking you this morning, friend, to search your heart. Most importantly, let the Holy Spirit search your heart and ask yourself, as I name these different kinds of darkness, ask yourself, is there any measure of that darkness or this one or that one in my life this Easter Sunday morning? Will you do that? It'll make the message so much more meaningful and helpful if you'll open your heart as we talk about these darknesses that characterized the day of Jesus' crucifixion, then of his resurrection. Search your heart. Lord, is there any of that darkness in me and in my life? First, we look at Jesus' disciples. And as we do, we'll see all kinds of darkness that consumed and characterized their lives. First, there was the darkness of desertion. When things began to turn against Jesus and the crisis point came and they needed more than ever to stand with him and be faithful to him, instead, what did these disciples do? They turned tail and they ran. Matthew 26, 56 simply says, then all the disciples forsook him and fled. They deserted Jesus when the real test of loyalty came, the darkness of desertion. Second, there was the darkness of denial. The darkness of denial. Old Peter, the big old brash, bragging fisherman, now disciple. Oh, Lord, he said, I'll never forsake you. I would never deny you. I would never turn my back. I'd die before I'd leave you, Lord. That's what he said in his big testimony. But now we see him warming his hands at the enemy's fire. And when a young lady accuses him, you're one of those followers of this Jesus. He denied Jesus. Peter denied his Lord, and he didn't do it once, but he did it three times with cursing, no, I don't even know the man. I want to tell you, friends, it was a mighty dark night there just before the Easter, I should say the rooster eerily crowed, when Peter denied our Lord. The darkness of denial. Third, with these disciples, there was also the darkness of drowsiness. The darkness of drowsiness. Oh, how dark, friends, this characteristic spiritually can be in the lives of professors of Jesus Christ. The darkness of drowsiness. Remember, Jesus had taken his disciples into a garden. He was under the great agony of the task that lay before him on the cross. He moves into that garden under that horrible burden, and he simply asks his disciples, do you remember the story? He asked them if they could watch with him for just a little while. Could you watch? Could you stay alert and on guard? But when Jesus returned, he found his disciples sleeping, weary and resting. They'd gotten drowsy and gone to sleep. Mark said their eyes were heavy, and thus they failed to be alert and on guard and to watch for Jesus. The darkness of drowsiness. Are you searching your heart this morning? There was also the darkness of disillusionment in the hearts of those disciples. Their master, their leader, had been captured. He'd been beaten. He'd been tormented. And now he was being crucified on an old Roman cross. Oh, we thought he'd be the one that would deliver us, said those disciples. But now, listen to me this morning. Now, all the circumstances, that's a key word here. The circumstances of their lives point in another direction until they became disillusioned, just disenchanted. Maybe he's not really the one we thought he was. Maybe his way isn't really the only way. The darkness of disillusionment, and then that dark shroud led these disciples right onto the darkness of flat-out discouragement, just discouraged with the cause of Christ, until finally we see them in John chapter 20, gathered in fear behind locked doors, completely enveloped in the darkness now, the darkness of plain old doubt. The darkness of doubt. These disciples were literally doubting everything they had believed regarding Jesus, and they're huddling behind locked doors, fearful. They've gone from disillusionment to discouragement, and now the darkness of doubt has enveloped their souls. One of them, Judas, succumbed to the darkness of utter despair. For remember, after he'd betrayed Jesus, he went out and hanged himself. But it further, rather ominously, tells us when he deliberately left the presence of Jesus at that Last Supper after Jesus had given him the sop of bread, indicated, you're the one that will betray me. The Bible tells us that Judas went out after Jesus identified his betrayal, and the scripture says, and it was night. Hear me this morning, that night of Judas' betrayal was not only the literal darkness of a real physical night, but there was the horrible darkness in Judas' heart of despair. Are you searching your heart this morning? Friends, I urge all of us this Easter Sunday to think about these facts. I want you to remember these were Jesus' own inner band of disciples. These were men who had actually followed Jesus for several years, and yet they allowed great darkness to envelop their souls and their lives. The darkness of desertion, of denial, of drowsiness, of disillusionment, the darkness of discouragement, then doubt, then despair. Though they'd spent all those years with Jesus, darkness had settled into the lives of these disciples. Could it be that some of us here this morning have been battling with some of these same realms of darkness? Say, preacher, I came on Easter Sunday because I wanted to feel good. I thought you'd give us a real upbeat, happy, feel-good sermon. I thought we'd be singing a bunch of songs that got me all excited and happy. And I hope you've been excited and are happy this morning. But I'm interested today to be sure that none of us is battling with any of these same realms of darkness in our lives on Easter Sunday. What about the darkness of desertion? Have you left the Lord? That darkness of denial, even of drowsiness, that's so typical of Christ professors, just to get a little indifferent, a little sleepy, eyes a little heavy until I'm no longer alert and really watching with the Lord. Friend, beware of spiritual darkness. It can so easily envelop your soul. Notice not only these disciples, but there were also others in this story. The story of the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ. There were others who had allowed themselves to be plunged into darkness also. There were very few people living in the light when Jesus was crucified and buried. There were others. I think of Pontius Pilate this morning, that Roman procurator who, in a sense, held Jesus' life right in his hands. You know, Pilate was guilty. I got thinking about this. Felt like the Lord spoke to me about it. Pilate was guilty of the darkness of dismissal. You see, in one way, and get this point this morning, in one way, Pilate never overtly rejected Jesus. He did not. He knew there was something special about this man. His wife came to him and warned him, "You better be careful. In dealing with this Jesus, Pilate knew there was something special, but in fear of the people, he just dismissed the Lord. Again, didn't really overtly reject him, just said, "I'm going to wash my hands of this innocent man's blood," not really rejecting him, I'm just sort of ignoring him. Hoping he'll go away. Hear me this morning, friends. That is an awful, awful black darkness to get into. The darkness of simple dismissal. Second, there was the darkness of delusion. Complete delusion. Do you remember the Jewish religious leaders of that day? Old Caiaphas, the high priest, the scribes, the Pharisees, in complete delusion in their failure to recognize that Jesus was the Messiah they'd been looking for so long. The darkness of delusion. Third, some of the Roman soldiers that day were guilty of the darkness of disrespect as they literally gambled for the cloak of Christ while he hung there on the cross. And for the actual executioners that day, those Roman executioners, they were in the midst of the darkness of destruction. Destroying the physical life of this innocent, holy man, and in so doing, destroying the hopes of so many of his followers. I think of that band of others this morning who gathered around the foot of the cross of Christ. That tiny band of Jesus' followers who were there that day. Even the women we read about at the beginning of the message, who were going to his place of burial, his tomb, early that morning in the first day of the week. I think of all those followers of Christ who were, God bless them, they were the ones that were hanging the closest there when their Lord was being crucified. But in them, there was the oppressive darkness of disappointment. Do you know that just disappointment in things spiritual or things church can get you headed a wrong direction? Friend, beware of that. Be on guard against that. These who had gathered around his cross were suffering in the darkness of disappointment. It seemed all their hopes had been dashed, all their dreams had been destroyed. This darkness was so prevalent. It was so powerful that it reached even the human side of our Lord. There was so much sin, so much deception, so much wickedness, so much anti-God spirit in that whole scenario that even the human side of Jesus was affected by darkness. And I'm being very careful in what I say here, but it was because he suffered the darkness of dread. As he prayed there in the garden, Father, oh, Father, as he sweat, as it were, great drops of blood, Father, would you let this cup of suffering pass from me? But nevertheless, your will be done, dear Father. The darkness of dread. But the Father, for a moment, turned his back on his son because of the sin burden he was carrying. And finally, our precious Savior experienced the darkness of death itself. And as the lifeless body of our Lord, I want you to think about it with me this morning. As the lifeless body of our Lord was laid in that cold hewn tomb, a great big old huge stone was rolled over into the entrance of that tomb, trapping within nothing but darkness, physical darkness surrounding the body of our Lord. Darkness within that tomb, keeping all the light without, it seemed that our Lord Jesus Christ was totally enveloped in the darkness of defeat. Utter and complete defeat, it seemed to be, in that awful moment as he was crucified, as he was taken down from the cross, as his body was laid in the tomb, as the big stone was rolled across. It looked like the darkness of defeat was everywhere, and all of these shades of darkness were because of the true prince of darkness, the darkness of the devil himself. For you see, friends, there were supernatural powers at work here. The forces of Almighty God and righteousness were pitted against the forces of the devil and eternal wickedness. Don't ever forget that. This was far more than just another Roman crucifixion. These were supernatural powers that were pitted against each other on this day. Indeed, as the songwriter wrote, there's a line that's been drawn through the ages. On that line stands the old rugged cross. On that cross, a battle is raging for the gain, listen, for the gain of man's soul or his loss. On one side march the forces of evil, all the demons and devils of hell. On the other, the angels of glory. And those forces meet on Golgotha's hill. The earth shakes with the force of the conflict. The sun refuses to shine, for there hangs God's Son in the balance. And then through the darkness, he cries, "It is finished." And as he began to utter those words, a new era, a new life, a new hope was starting to begin with the words of Jesus. As he hung there in the darkness, the darkness, the darkness, and cried, "It is finished." For you see, on that bleak and black day, it seemed that the whole world had gone back to its pre-creation state, the earth without form and void, and darkness upon the face of the deep. It was so dark. Think about it this morning. It was so dark. Darker than it had ever been before in this old world, on this old earth. It was so dark. But Oh, thank God for that conjunction of contrast. But, so dark, but then came the morning. Then came the morning. Don't ever forget it, friends. The darker the night, the brighter the light shines. Friends, the darkness of the crucifixion and all that went with it was not the end of the story. For on that third day, Jesus triumphantly rose from the grave. And as he did, he dispelled all that darkness, bringing forth the glorious light of resurrection. And his resurrection shattered the chains of sin and the dark death off, chains of death and sin and the darkness that prevailed. He broke those chains and dispelled that darkness as he rose from the grave, as the Old Testament prophet Isaiah foretold and later Matthew repeated, those who walked in darkness. And do you know that was you, friend? And you, and you, and you, and you, that was I. The old prophet wrote it first and then Matthew picked it up in the New Testament. Those who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Through his resurrection, Jesus Christ became the beacon of light for all humanity. And friends, the light of his resurrection continues to shine brightly even today, guiding those who believe out of the awful darkness and into the fullness of God's great light. And I say hallelujah. Hallelujah for the light of resurrection that dispels the darkness. Yes? Yes, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, darkness everywhere, but then came the morning. Praise the Lord. This morning, as we've been doing various years over the past, it's become somewhat of a tradition here at Heath Church. We're going to enjoy together a little practice, as I said, that we've been doing now for several years, called the flowering of the cross. Those of you who've been here before, so many of you have asked, are we going to do that again this Easter? And indeed we are. It'd actually be the flowering of the crosses this morning because of crowd and time. We have two crosses. But here's what we're going to do, and I want you to listen carefully. This isn't just a meaningless little ritual, just something to do on Easter Sunday morning to make a couple crosses look pretty. No, no. Remember, friends, that the Roman cross was nothing but a heinous tool of awful, awful execution. Nothing pretty about it. Horrible, reproachful, awful. But what makes the cross beautiful is the resurrection. And that's why we flower these crosses on Easter Sunday morning. And it gives each one of us a moment to personally thank the Lord for the resurrection of Jesus. And I want you to do this. And our ushers are coming to direct you and help you. We're going to be moving from the middle aisle. Each of you pick up one flower and then go over and put it in the cross there behind the little chicken wire that'll hold it on. Some of you tall fellows may want to get up toward the top. And we'll go, this side will go that direction, this side will go this direction, then file right back into your seat if you will. We're going to have some good music while we're doing that, so enjoy the music and let's be honoring the Lord. And you make it a personal act of worship. As you place that flower, Lord, I thank you for the resurrection. Maddie and Lexi are coming to sing first, and then we'll be enjoying some other good music. Worship the Lord during this special celebration.
Thank you. but she found the Savior gone to invite unto her said, why seek among the dead? He is risen, do not cry. Go tell the others he's alive. Resurrection day proclaims Christ the risen Savior reigns. Oh, what joy my heart reveals. I know my Redeemer lives. Men may mock his holy name. They may say he never came, but we're gathered here today 'cause Jesus came our way. So we'll shout it Christ is risen, he's alive. Resurrection day proclaims Christ the risen Savior reigns. Oh, what joy my heart.
Wash me in.
Thank you, ladies. That was supposed to be a pastor's wives trio. Marilyn got a very bad throat, so kind of a pastor's wife, pastor's daughter trio. Worked out well. I tell you what we're going to do. It's about time to go home. I'm going to ask Tom's family to come up and close us out with a song, and I want a few of you here in the front, while they're singing, maybe both front rows, grab the rest of these flowers. Let's fill up the crosses. We'll be taking them out in the yard right after the service if you want to get some pictures. Give them a minute to get them out there, but let's praise the Lord as we worship together, closing out this service. Don't you love the risen Lord? Do you love Him with all your heart this Sunday morning? Been a wonderful, wonderful morning of worship. While they're singing, you two front rows, go to work here. Let's fill it up, make them look really good. God bless you. Thank you. Praise the Lord. Hasn't it been good to be in God's house this Easter Sunday morning? I praise Him. I'm going to dismiss in prayer. While I'm doing that, our ushers are going to get these crosses out in the front yard where you can take a photo if you'd like to. Give them just a minute to get that done. Thank you again for being here this morning. Yes. Okay. Oh my. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Ed. Ed, go ahead and give him a hand. Ed said one of our young men up here was singing in perfect harmony with the ladies' trio. So that's what he was saying if you couldn't hear him. Thank you again for being here. Let's stand together. Precious Father in heaven, we thank you for the wonderful joys of the resurrection. We thank you, Lord, that you're alive and you are alive forevermore. How we praise you for that wonderful truth today. It's not only the truth of your word, but it is the truth in our hearts this morning. And how we thank you and praise you and give you glory. Please bless everyone who's here today. May we go in resurrection power, rejoicing in your might and in your strength. We're trusting you, believing you for continued help and continued blessing. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Amen. You are dismissed. Thank you so much for coming.